let's explore the Andromeda. So this
yes.
is what, thank you, Jaime. This is what we are going to be doing now. But first of all, a quick recap on the Academy objective. Our purpose on this Academy is that you are able to fine tune and, let's say, polish out your configurations to make the most of the use of the Android application. As you know, because you have been through you completed the form and registered, and you have been giving us follow-up information, we assume that you know Tracker. So we are going to be using terms of Tracker, assuming that you know what we are saying. Let me open this so that I can track my time. And so we are going to be basing all our presentations on Tracker knowledge and the HIS2 knowledge in general. And the way we are going to structure the day today is that we are in the first session. In this 20 minutes, I'm going to give you an overview of the Android application. And then Jaime, he will introduce himself later today, in the next session. He will give you an overview of the metadata we are going to use. And then after 11, you are going to have practical sessions to get you set up with the Android application and the DHIS2 configuration for the rest of the Academy. We are going to use one use case. Then from 1 to 2, we are going to have 1 hour of optional questions and answers sessions, or support is optional, stay if you want. And the rest of the days we will have similar sessions from 9 to 10 and from 1 to 2 based on your time zone. We have also Andres with us today, and Jaime, we have two Jaimes. We will be supporting us during the 5 days to answer your questions and staying and looking at the Slack channel for supporting and answering questions. Hello, Andres, and thank you very much.
Hello to everyone.
Andres is a developer of the Android app, so he knows all the details. So let me go to the session. Again, it's 20 minutes. At the end of the session, you should know broadly what is the Android app. These are the aspects I'm going to cover. I'm going to be fast in all of them, but we do have sessions to go in detail, so don't worry about that. But of course, if you have remaining questions, stay later at 1 or put them on Slack. First thing that I'm not going to demo, but we want you to know, is that you can, or to make easier the login, you can put your URL in a QR code generator and then just scan a QR code to type the URL. This is useful for you and for your end users, as typing the URL is usually the most cumbersome part of the login. And then if your device allows for biometric identification, fingerprint mainly, you will be able to use it after first login too. The homepage. What do we have in the homepage? As you know, this Android app compiles the 3 data models of the HIS2 datasets, event programs, tracker programs. We are trying to mask the complexity to the end users so that for them, they all look the same. But you know, by looking at this little word here, that for example, this is an event program and you have 25 events. This is a data set, you have 25 data sets reported. And this is a tracker program. In the case of tracker, we are listing the name of your tracked entity type. So this is how you can differentiate, but for the user, they all look like activities. I'm going to work on antenatal care today, work on child health today. I'm going to report my aggregate. The programs that are listed here are using the icon and the color that you configure on your server, and the user needs to have either view or capture permissions. So if you set them as no access, they will not be listed here. The user needs to be able to either see or capture information for the program or dataset and the unit that he or she is assigned to. This is for you to keep as a reference. These are the icons that we use all over the app. Of course, you have the slides in EDX, and we hope you keep this presentation as reference because it has a lot of information. So these are the icons that we use, only to highlight that if you don't see any sync icons, it means that your data is synchronized and is in the server. These are the ones we use for status. And just to explain you that if you see this little line here, it means the data is only view. You cannot, for any reason, either permissions, expiry date, enrollment completed, you can only view the data. It cannot be modified. And now let's go to the app. In the app, you will see here, let me set it up. 1 second. Okay. Why? 1 second, sorry about that. Here we are. Okay, so we have, okay, I need to move this. We have filters in all screens, home, datasets, events, tracker, and TEI. Some of them are based on your configuration, but again, keep this table as a reference. And let me show you how this works. So here, this is the application. This is the home screen, as you have seen. And the filters are all over the app, either for date, photo unit, sync status, and they change based on the screen that you are in. So you can use the table as reference for which filters are available or not. You can configure the visibility of your filters in the Android Settings web app. We have a session on Thursday about the Android Settings web app. You will learn all the detailed configurations you can make by using the app, but one of them are the filters. If you think these are too many filters for your users, you can disable the filters and decide what is displayed here. And they work differently. If they are dates, you have current, past, and future periods. And of course, you can specify custom periods of time or specific dates. Anytime will not apply any filter. For the org units, you can either search. If you know the name of your org unit, you need to click, and now the filter is applied. Or you can open your hierarchy and make the selection. Sync ones are ticks, are based on ticks. So you can say, okay, do I have, oh, sorry, I'm confusing the app. It has some delay because of the screen sharing. Do I have any sync error, for example? And then assign to me and TEI follow-up, which is a new filter, are toggle. So this will only appear if you have any program configured as such. So there is one more way of filtering. I hope you are all familiar with the concept of working lists. So if you have working lists configured, they will appear here. And they are just one more filter. How do they work? This is your Capture app. And when you make a filter and save the filter, they appear here, right? So these are your working lists that you are seeing in the application. When the user selects a working list, we are showing you which filter is actually in action. But the user cannot change it because working lists are configured in the server. This is just to help you make easier the filtering for your users. You could, for example, hide all these filters and leave only the working list with an intuitive name, for example. So this is about the filtering, and then one very fancy functionality that you will see in detail again on Thursday, day four, are the analytics. You will see this bottom navigation bar all across the app, and the options depend on the screen where you are. So in this case, in the home screen, we do have data entry and we have analytics. Analytics are configured again on the Android Settings web app. So you can see here that I'm making groups, antenatal clinic, malaria program in the home screen, right? You can do the same for your programs or data sets. And then go back to the app. in each one of them, let's see, malaria, okay, the user can change the value type, for example, or filter. You can filter either by period, so I want to see the last 4 weeks, including the current week, okay? It defaults to the original display when you apply filters, but this is your data now. I think I do prefer the table for this one. And then, let me reset this, and you can, the user can also filter by your unit. So either all my units or a selection. And again, same hierarchy applies. So this is how the filtering works. Let's go back to data entry, how data sets look in the Android app. So you know how to identify a data set now, right? So I open a data set. And this is your list of reported data sets. This means it's completed. This means it's open. So let's open one of them. Here you have the name, you have the period, and you have your unit. You can also go to details. For this, here's the icon and the color. This data set is open. Let's go back to data entry, same navigation bar. These are your sections when you create a data set. And then inside a data set, you can have more than one table. As you know, with these little arrows, you can adjust the width of your column, first column, and this red star is telling you that these fields are mandatory. The datasets also support validation rules, but we will have a session for this on Wednesday. Oh, they are missing mandatory fields. I'm not going to stop there now. So let's go to our events. Why is that coming up? I'm using demo mode. I should not have notification. Okay, sorry about that. So let's look at our events. Have you seen this? This means I have local data that is not synced. These are the icons I was explaining at the beginning. So this is a list of events. The lists are all the same. As you can see, data sets, events, or tracked entity instances. In the case of events and tracked entity instances, we are displaying here the first attributes marked as displayed in the configuration, and if you expand it, if you had more, they will be listed here. But when it's collapsed, we only put the value for the first three. These events are completed, as you can see. So let's open one of them. So what you can see here, these are your sections. These are the different sections that you have configured. And then the different data entry types. This is a date, this is a number. You can display legends in your data entry. So let's say I'm gonna say 34 and move to the next one. So how is the legend looking now? Ah, same color. So what if I say 65? I'm using the keyboard, so it's everything's a bit more visible. Yeah, so I'm a bit older now. You have also visual data entry. We will see this tomorrow, how to configure the application. This is how option sets look if they have more than 15 options, I think. Of course, users can search. And yeah, this is also visual. What you have here, I mean, this is telling you that your sections have one data element and is complete, one of one, one out of one. But if we remove one, you see, now you are missing one, and the spinner is also telling you that you are missing one. Like you are 80% done. You can change the calendar view. We have calendar, we do have spinner, and the app will remember your last choice next time when you open, as you can see. Now, oh, I deleted it, sorry, accept. Now it's completed again. So let's save. I'm going to finish. Oh, sorry. So again, Now I have an event that has been modified and not synced to the server. I want to move to the tracker programs now. So I'm going to use the child program for this. So this is your list of tracked entity instances. To see a list of tracked entity instances, you need to have this display in front page list enabled. Otherwise, you will see the search form and you will be forced to search. This little icon here is telling you that you have overdue events, you see, and the date of when the event should have happened. So if we open Emma, this is the TEI dashboard. This is where you have your events. Again, here we have the navigation bar. You have TEI analytics. We will see this on Thursday again. We have relationships and we have notes. This is how we navigate. And then going back to our search, I didn't tell you, but what we are seeing here again is the list of tracked entity attributes, in this case marked as displayed in list, and the enrollment per unit. And when you search, if you don't know if your patient is enrolled in this program, you can search by all person. These are the tracked entity type attributes common across all programs. The way we use the color of the app that you configure, see this one, is forcing your search. It's by changing the color of the application based on the program that you select. Let's go back to our child program. And then to create a new tracked entity instance, you know this already, I think, you need to search. And then only after you search, you will be for the creating, but the fields that you enter will be propagated to the registration form. So it's just one step that we are putting in the middle. So we have seen the tracked entity instance dashboard. We have seen the events. So now let's look at the, how to edit details. So the details of your tracked entity instance are here, enrollment details, and here your attributes. This is where we add the pictures. Let's take a picture. I think I should be here. Hello. Oh, I have hanging. And so one, we have a picture. Let me save this. You see, this is how we use it. It will be in the list now. And these are our events. Other things that you can do here, well, this is the incident date, this is the enrollment date, and this is the enrolling our unit. You can mark your TEIs as follow-up, and this is the status of the enrollment. Now, these three dots are very interesting. This is where you can delete your enrollment or TEI if you have permissions. This is where you can change the display of your events. Here, they are grouped by stage. We have 5 postnatal visits, but you can list them chronologically, and they are not grouped by type. In this case, this is where you create events. Now, if we go back to the other grouping, which is easier, I think, when you have repeatable stages, you create them from here, if the user can. Birth is not repeatable, so we cannot. Here, you change the status of the enrollment. You can complete or deactivate, and this is a very interesting feature that is not very known, which is that you can see all the enrollments of your tracked entity instance. These are the active ones, and these are the ones where you could enroll this TEI. And you can go to what we call the tracked entity, the person dashboard. So here you can see the different enrollments and navigate them from there. I think we have seen almost everything. We will have a session for maps, but I only want you to see that the maps are here. And with this, I'm finishing and we will go to the break. but you have maps in the programs that have some attributes or data elements configured as coordinates or polygons. So let me find one with coordinates. Yay. So this is how you navigate your different tracked entity instances if they have coordinates, some don't. And you can, of course, display relationships. Let's display our relationships. So here we see how they are linked. And you can also, if we use this, you can navigate, because you can, let's say, where am I? So it positions you in your current location. And then if you navigate, if you select one tracked entity and then navigate, it will open your default navigation application to help you get there from your current location. We have also maps in the relationships, but you will see that in the session on Wednesday, if I'm not mistaken. And I'm going to leave it here because we are already 7 minutes late, but I'm 21 minutes presentation. Hi, Miss, I kept it on time. I'm gonna stop sharing here. And how many are we now? 45. Okay, so welcome to those that joined a bit later. We are in principle in a break. Is that correct, Jaime?
Yes, let's, yeah, go ahead.
So just that, again, this was a very quick overview. We will have sessions to go deep into all of the functionalities. And if you have specific questions, please stay at one. We will be here for you. Over to you, Jaime.
Thank you very much, Bertrand. Okay, so let's do a 2 minutes break in case someone needs to go to the toilet, grab a drink, and we will start at 10:30. Okay, 5 minutes later, but we gave 5 minutes.
We started 5 minutes later the session, so we need to recover. Thank you very much. Gonna go get water too.
Yeah, thanks.